The Federal Democratic Republic of Ethiopia is the second largest and one of the most influential and well-known countries in Africa. Ethiopia is also famously one of the few countries to almost completely avoid European colonialism, aside from a brief stint with the Italians in World War II. I talked a little bit about Ethiopia's geopolitical challenges about a month ago in my video about Egypt's geopolitical challenges, but what are the geographic blessings and challenges that Ethiopia faces as a nation? This video is brought to you by Squarespace and generous patrons on Patreon who now get to see deleted scenes from past videos as a $5 plus perk. So first, let's set our bearings. Obviously, this is Africa. And if we look here to the Horn of Africa, this here is Ethiopia. Ethiopia is one of the first countries ever inhabited by humans, as it's right around where the species Homo sapiens first evolved. However, nowadays, Ethiopia faces many different struggles. Many, perhaps unsurprisingly, relating in some way to its geography. Applying a population density map over a topographical map, we can see that a large portion of the country's 110 million citizens live within the Ethiopian highlands, a vast system of mountains and plateaus with swaths of fertile soil between 1800 and 3000 meters altitude supporting large-scale agriculture, forming essentially the core of the country. These highlands are split by the Great Rift Valley, through which flows the Awash River, flowing into Lake Abe on the border with Djibouti, and forming what is known as an Endorheic Basin. The lake is located in the middle of the Afar Triangle, a lowland region right at the end of the Great Rift Valley, which would pose as a major defensive gap for invading armies were it not for how hot and inhospitable the area is. This low-lying area is also home to Dalol, within the Donak Hill Depression, which has the highest average year-round temperature of any inhabited area on Earth, averaging around 35 degrees Celsius year-round, and in the summer getting almost as hot as it was in Portland, Oregon 2 weeks ago. The lowest it has ever gotten in Dalol is 21 degrees Celsius. So, I'm no military strategist, but you probably wouldn't want to take your army through here. Okay, I'm gonna be real with y'all though, this really looks like the set of an early episode of Star Trek Next Generation. Ethiopia is populated by dozens of different ethnic groups, the four largest of which being the Oromos, Amharas, Somalis, and Tigrays, together making up nearly three-quarters of the population. Outside the capital Addis Ababa and the eastern city of Dire Dawa, both of whom are classified as charter cities, Ethiopia is divided into 10 ethno-linguistic regional states known as Kilioch, those being Afar, Amhara, Bene Shungul-Gumuz, Gambela, Harari, Oromia, Sidama, Somali, the Southern Nations Nationalities and Peoples Region, and Tigray. This system has only been in place since 1992 though, and perhaps one of Ethiopia's greatest challenges has been keeping all these different groups together, as exemplified in past conflicts in Eritrea and the Eastern Ogaden region, and currently in Tigray.
Okay, editing KhAnubis here just to say that I picked a really interesting time to talk about Ethiopia. Basically, there's a lot of drama unfolding in the northern region of Tigray right now, and demonetization aside, it's also something I'm absolutely not qualified to cover in the light it deserves. I will acknowledge, though, how important this issue is, very, and link some better sources made by more qualified individuals than me, but ultimately, that's not what this video is about. And besides, if I even tried to cover this while things are still unfolding, I would misrepresent everything.
Separatism and insurgencies, however, are not the only problems Ethiopia faces within, with problems including poverty, food shortages, corruption, poor infrastructure, and lack of access to healthcare. Things are steadily improving though, with the poverty rate dropping from 44% in 2000 to 30% in 2011. Food, however, still remains an issue, as while higher food prices mean higher incomes for farmers, they also make it harder for many to afford this food. Although only around 15% of Ethiopia's land area is arable, 45 to 50% of its economy relies on agriculture, meaning the economy as a whole could potentially be vulnerable to droughts or flooding, and well, also the food supply, you know. Infrastructure, though, has been a major focus in recent years. One of the biggest projects touted in Ethiopia is the partially Chinese-built Addis Ababa-Djibouti Railway, a freight and passenger railway connecting Addis Ababa and Dire Dawa to Ethiopia's neighbor Djibouti, providing landlocked Ethiopia with a connection to the sea. This railway was inaugurated in October 2016 in Ethiopia and about a year later in Djibouti. However, it did not commence commercial operation until January 2018. The railway was built without proper connections in mind, with little in the way of trunk lines, branch lines, storage facilities, or even road connections. The goal was largely to build a cheap railway first, with it being assumed that all the connections would be easy to install. However, even after commercial opening, many passenger stations are located far outside the city centers of whichever city they serve. The new Foothild station in Addis Ababa, for instance, is located outside the city limits, and the last 3 kilometers of road on the route hadn't even been finished when it was opened, meaning a taxi between the station and the city center could often cost more than the train tickets themselves. Within Ethiopia's borders, however, only flows one navigable river, the Baro, which flows for 306 kilometers before joining with the Pibor to make the Soba River, a major tributary of the White Nile. The only major city along the Baro, though, is Gambela, with a population of around 40,000. Needless to say, Ethiopia is not exactly a river-based nation. It is, however, home to Lake Tana, which is the source of the Blue Nile, a major tributary of the Nile, itself fed by numerous other rivers in the country, giving Ethiopia the perhaps somewhat ironic nickname of Africa's Water Tower. Now, of course, about a month ago, I made this exact video, but for Egypt, in which I mentioned the dispute between Egypt and Ethiopia over the Grand Ethiopian Renaissance Dam, or GERD. So, what does it all look like from Ethiopia's perspective? For context, the dam is a project Ethiopia recently completed near its western border on the Blue Nile, which joins with the White Nile in Khartoum, Sudan, and creates the Nile Nile we all know in Egypt. Since the Blue Nile is by far the largest tributary of the Nile, Egypt has expressed concern that the building of the dam and the filling of the reservoir behind it would choke their water supply should it happen too fast. Thus, Egypt wanted the reservoir to be filled over a longer period, say 12 years, however, Ethiopia hoped to have it filled in closer to 4 years, as it would be a major source of electricity for the country, potentially even to export to neighboring countries. The reservoir started filling up in July 2020, and is expected to take 4 to 7 years to fill to capacity, depending on what happens in the reservoir and further downstream. Ethiopia might not exactly have the best geography a country could ask for, however, it never being colonized has garnered itself huge respect from other African nations, and in fact the African Union's operations are largely based in Addis Ababa. How Ethiopia avoided colonialism, though, doesn't so much have to do with its geography as its history and politics. Covering that would require a separate video, though, which maybe I'll make in the future, but also please don't hold me to that. I'm not making any promises yet, this is still just a maybe.
Have you or a loved one been diagnosed with mesothelioma? You should probably get that checked out. Anyway, let me talk about Squarespace.
Squarespace is a website builder that helps you build a beautiful website for your business or product or YouTube channel or hot dog stand with little more than a few clicks and a few minutes of your time. In fact, whether you're a beginner or an advanced website builder, Squarespace doesn't hold you back, whether you actually know how to code or you actually have a social life. With Squarespace, you can set up a blog, start an email list, even collect donations, along with dozens of other features to build the best possible website to represent your business. Go to squarespace.com/KhAnubis or click the link in the description and use the code KhAnubis at checkout for 10% off your order of a website or domain. Yes, they also give you domains, isn't that convenient? Ask your doctor before using Squarespace. Side effects may include having a nice-looking website, people thinking you're a professional, people being able to navigate your website easily, extreme satisfaction, finding stock footage of happy people on the internet, or still not having a life because you're a YouTuber.